Welcome to the world of Westeros, the society at the forefront of HBO's television phenomenon, Game of Thrones, adapted from George R.R. Martin's A Song of Fire and Ice. On this continent, you will see stark depictions of a distorted, fantastical medieval society. Kings rule the lands, and families of royalty, both just and corrupt, clash for the Iron Throne. Now sure, there are battles, and there are zombies, and there are dragons, but beneath the surface lies a complex tale of how society evolves from a patriarchal offspring into a land dominated by powerful women. Before we begin, it is critical to illustrate the basic principles that define the feminist theory. More generally, its intended goal seeks to maintain equality between males and females, and works to evaluate social constraints in a variety of socioeconomic structures. Today, we will apply this theory to HBO's Powerhouse series, and focus on examining how conflict is derived through societal constraints in relation to gender, and criticize various aspects of the parts which create the whole. And so, as we begin our analysis, we can form three different examples of such instances: the Sirens, the Fighters, and the Matriarchs. Let's begin with the Sirens, those whose last names hold no merit in a society of kings and queens. Here, Marxism becomes an additional threat. If you are not of royal blood, as a man, you have a plethora of opportunities. However, for women with no last name any man wants to replace, one must turn to their gravest injustice, their objectification in society, and wield it like armor. Prostitution is a thriving industry in Westeros and allows many characters to rise. For example, the ill-fated Roz, who tells her close friend,
"It's not easy for girls like us to dig our way out."
These words remain unflinchingly true, as her only means to gain a better life through the sexual desires of men at the top. While Roz did not make it very far, the primary example of such powerful reclamation is in the story of the Red Priestess Melisandre. Melisandre uses her sexuality as a weapon and as means to climb the ladder of power. Society deems women as little more than sexual objects, and Melisandre understands her circumstance and uses it to her advantage. For example, she seduces the throne contender Stannis Baratheon and ultimately destroys his entire reign, all to fulfill her own religious desires. She continually uses her body to get men to do as she commands. She lures Gendry into her bed, only to steal his royal blood, and taunts a mangled Jon Snow to fulfill a prophecy she deems true. It is the only option for these women to gain the favor and trust of the men in charge, utilizing a perceived disadvantage in society for personal gains. The second category spotlights the Fighters, and here the queer theory dynamically intertwines. For noble-born women, gender roles dictate every move and desire. One must spend their days acting ladylike, practicing knitting and bending with the handmaidens, waiting to be swept off their feet. That is the dream for a young Sansa Stark, who belittles her younger sister, Arya, for rejecting this way of life. On the contrary, Arya wants to be a swordswoman, and so she trains in secret, knowing all of Westeros forbids it. She shoots an arrow sharper than any of her brothers, yet, on the night of the king's arrival, she is forced to wear big and bold dresses to impress a prince. Arya's soulmate is one Brienne of Tarth, with rather similar motivations. Born to a royal family, Brienne fled her land to become the Kingsguard to Renly Baratheon, a traditional male duty. She is ridiculed for her mannish figure and brutish demeanor, but proves her enemies gloriously wrong with any combat in which she finds herself. Both Arya and Brienne deal with the unfortunate social constraints of a society which does not deem women capable enough to fight, just as the Sirens use their disadvantage, their sexual objectification, to gain the upper hand. Both these two swordswomen fool their combatants with a perception of weakness and are able to defeat even the mightiest of men due to this fatal mischaracterization. Finally, we have the third category, which we will call the Matriarchs. Youthful and wise, these women have been born to great privilege in comparison to the Sirens, yet, just like the Fighters, are treated merely as pawns in a political chess match with men moving the pieces. Daenerys Targaryen begins her journey being forced to marry our barbaric tribe leader in order for her abusive brother to gain an army. In the eyes of most, she is simply the object which fortifies an alliance and who will give her new husband a son of his own. Cersei Lannister is similarly used by her bully father Tywin to ensure the family name continues to dominate. She is married off to the King on the Iron Throne and is used to bear his royal children. However, these powerful ladies have much more on their mind, as Daenerys echoes in later sentiments.
I am not your little princess, and I will take what is mine with fire.
Dany has her brother executed and births three beautiful dragons who aid her in asserting dominance. She outsmarts the whims of many ruling men who do not take her seriously, soon gathering an army larger than ever seen before to take the throne for herself. Similarly, Cersei takes matters into her own hands, poisoning her royal husband and setting the fanatical religious court aflame. She becomes the king on her own, with men and women alike fearing her wrath. Ultimately, these leading ladies outmatch their male counterparts, not with their body or swordsmanship, but with their willpower, courage, and intelligence. In the greater scheme of things, what is essential to the storylines of these complex female characters is the society which deems them incapable of pursuing their intended goals. Marital and sexual objectification oversees the lives of every woman mentioned earlier, in one shape or form. Interestingly, in Game of Thrones, all women use their disadvantages as a primary source for evolution. The lower class climb the ladder through sexual exploitation with ulterior motives. The fighters defy all their naysayers and become most highly skilled through the art of the unexpected. And the matriarchs outsmart all clever men with wit and intelligence, taking what is rightfully theirs from those who doubted their capabilities. The most essential line on this show is uttered by Cersei Lannister in episode 7 of the first season. She spears,
"When you play the Game of Thrones, you win or you die. There is no middle ground."
Excitingly, although in early episodes it seems all will never become just, the women of Game of Thrones have triumphantly shown that they are certainly winning the game.